This is WBSM On Demand. It's time for South Coast Now with Chris McCarthy. Streaming live on WBSM.com and the WBSM app. Call 508-996-0500. Text us using app chat on the WBSM app. Now, Chris McCarthy.
Good morning. Good morning. It's Friday, last day of the week for me. We'll have a good show today. We have something a little different and something the same. At 10 o'clock, we'll have Representative Chris Markey, who's coming in to talk about the Karen Reed case. As you know, Chris was a prosecutor in the district attorney's office in Bristol County and now is a defense attorney anywhere in the Commonwealth. Probably Rhode Island, too. But I think Chris is following the case, and it's good to get someone like him who's local, knows the local courts, and give us a perspective on it, because it really is one of the biggest stories in the country. Then at 11 o'clock, we will have Democrat State Committee man Charlie Mata. Charlie was reelected to the Democrat State Committee in a election last time around that with a presidential ballot, right? So at the same time we were nominating Joe Biden here on Super Tuesday, we were also putting Charlie Mata back on the Democrat State Committee. So he's going to be in here with Tom Hodgson. Tom will be, of course, representing the Republicans, and Charlie Mata will be representing the Democrats. And now we're joined by Chris Markey. Good morning, Chris. How are you?
Good, Chris. How are you?
I'm doing well. So, this case keeps getting bigger and bigger. The Karen Reed case. It is funny because some of the most interesting stuff is actually happening outside. You know, in the courtroom and the audience, even the journalists who are getting into battles. And so, what is it like to have a case with so much media speculation on it? It's difficult, right?
I actually think it's pretty dangerous in the long run. I think it's great to have people accessible to it and have journalists be able to write about it. But I think the personalities of people shouldn't get involved. And it takes away from the legitimacy of a trial, one way or the other. So I think that's why they have certain requirements to not protest in front of the courthouse. They don't want that influencing. They should be, for example, when jurors enter a courtroom, everyone stands. And it's in honor of that obligation.
Okay.
And the responsibility that goes with it. Just like a judge comes in, you all rise. I think that this is unfair to jurors in the long run. It puts a much more difficult experience for them in a case like this, and it's like a typical case, but the media takes over,
right,
and makes it into something more. I'm not saying that we shouldn't have the media in there, because I think it's a huge responsibility and that they should be there, because I think it holds people accountable.
Okay.
I used to have this conversation with the editorial board at the Standard Times. I used to say, when you need to be in the courtrooms and you need to be in City Hall, you need to be at the State House. You make us better our job. And that makes the prosecutor, the judge, the defense attorney better. But at the same token, is you shouldn't be able to take on a personality because of it.
Chris, last night I listened to a podcast from Court TV, a long one. It was the cross-examination of the property owner's house. who's a retired Boston police detective, I couldn't help but to think, he sounded defensive, but I'm trying to put myself in his place, you know. He wasn't arrested, nothing. He had someone die at his house. His version of the story is he didn't even know what happened. But his whole life's been turned upside down.
Yes, but I think he has played a major role in having that.
Okay.
Okay? I mean, this is why you have cross-examination. And okay, just as a side note, I mean, that lawyer, technically, as a legal person and as a cross-examination, that may have been one of the best that I've ever seen.
Really?
Yeah. He, again, that a lot of that has to do with having a good investigator who gets all this information okay, and knows the details of the case. So he's clearly prepared. He had tons of information. But the idea of cross-examination is to cross-examine someone on what they testify on direct examination to challenge it. And I thought that his appearance, and again, at the end of the case, the judge instructs the jury on, you're the sole judges of the credibility of the witnesses. For you to determine their credibility, use your common sense. When you use your common sense, you know how to size up somebody. You do it every day. And it's not just what they say, it's how they say it. It's how they answer questions for one side as opposed to how they answer another.
The judge will tell the jury.
Yes.
Oh,
so that's part of the instruction.
Okay.
And when you size him up, he's pretty simple, straightforward story, right?
Yeah.
And then you start to question it. There's four police cruisers, an ambulance, maybe a fire truck out there, and you don't wake up, and that's only like 35 feet from your window, and you're a cop. I find that totally incredible.
And the dog. He said the dog didn't wake up either.
Yeah.
I
don't have a pet, so I don't know. But
believe
yeah,
me. I mean, dogs. But
the idea
that's their job.
So that's the stuff that he was able to get.
Yeah.
I mean, we had a house across the street from me, and when the kids were little, there was college kids living there, and the police were there all the time. And when you can hear it,
right?
Door shut, cars, anything, you know. And it's, you wake up and you take a look out the window, and if you're a police officer and you see all that and you don't go out, I find that hard to believe. The phones being erased and all of that, and him playing like Jimmy the Dunce on the whole thing. He's a police officer. He knows the value of a forensic evidence on the phone and all that.
It was amazing when he tried to deny that. Like,
yeah.
I have no training. And he came off very defensive.
Well, I think he came off evasive.
Yeah, evasive. That's a better word.
And sometimes, you know, you don't have to lie all the time, right? Like, I mean, I don't know how to say it other than, like, you're lying when the truth will do.
Right.
Right? Like, why are you lying? So I thought that cross-examination was very good. I think that some of the stuff is, you know, I think a little bit over the top on the defense side too, but they're laying, like I said the last time, those little nuggets so that they can argue at the end. Does it make it sense? Does it make believable? Is it possible? Is it probable? Those are all words that the judge is going to use at the end of the case when you talk about credibility of a witness and instructing the jurors. So when you look at it that way and you have all these little nuggets, is, you know, some of the things, and they also, the judge will say, you know, you can believe all of what a witness says, bits and pieces of what a witness says, or nothing of what a witness says. It's okay, up to you as the sole judges of the facts of the case. So all of that plays into it. And they, I think, played a little bit into that there's some things that you can believe from some of the witnesses, and there's some things you totally cannot believe. And I think they're playing that pretty well on the defense side.
I thought the particular questions about the phone, right, that he sent his phone in, or he updated his plan or something, right? He turned the phone in, and he, look, I'm about as knowledgeable about phones. I don't know about you. I don't know that much about them. So when the guy was saying, hey, I didn't realize a couple of things. Like, I thought all the data transfers over to my new phone. I didn't realize. But then when they get it down to the fact that he believes he turned his phone in one day before he got the letter that he says he never got, that came out on the 23rd, he said he thought he turned his phone in on the 22nd. I thought, that just doesn't... I mean, even if it's... I don't know. Like you said, it
there's
evasive.
Okay. It's not evasive. If he does it the 22nd and he gets the letter the 23rd, okay. Right? You know that the lawyers were talking about it.
Right.
You know that there's someone has knowledge. And does someone call him and say, hey, they're going to get your phone?
Right.
And then that's when that happens. But all, like, it's just, it's more than coincidence. But the question I have is it still getting to the point of, you could have all these lies.
Right.
But did she still do it? You right. know what I mean? Like, their stupidity. And the other thing I'm amazed at.
All right.
Is just how much these people drink.
I know they really do drink a lot.
Oh my God, it's unbelievable. I think one witness said it was a weekend night. I had normal 6 to 8 beers on a night. I'm like, I'm not saying everyone has it every once in a while, but when he says it's normal every Saturday night, I'm having 8 beers, and then you're drinking with your high school nephew.
Yeah,
and then I'm 56. The idea of going out after the bars close or going to someone's house, that ended when I was like 25,
yes.
28, maybe.
Right.
Right? I'm not a prude, but
right.
I mean, I just find that hard to believe that a bunch of 50-year-olds are going to go back and drink more.
But they did.
Yeah. What? It's crazy.
I thought the conversation about the phones, again, the federal agent that is involved in the case, that they were asking whether he knew, whether Albert knew that the guy had destroyed his phone or something along those lines. In other words, they had coordinated and both gotten rid of their phones. I thought that was pretty interesting.
Yeah, I think it plays into the question is why are they lying? Are they lying because, and I think an objective view of it is you really have to question their credibility. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying it in a, I have it slant, because I still think of myself, I believe police officers, all that,
yes.
But this guy's, in a private citizen capacity. Is he lying about the death of him, of O'Keefe, or is he lying about something that they were doing?
Yes.
At the house that would put them, and then all of a sudden this thing just snowballed and it just got crazier and crazier and crazier, and then they were like, oh, we gotta get rid of everything.
Right.
I don't know, but it clearly plays into that.
Because again, this is me, and I have a hard time believing that these police officers murdered John O'Keefe and then framed this woman for doing it. And all the people involved and everything, but they're not, as you put it, they're not really helping themselves, because they are being.
But there's a difference, right?
Okay.
That you said they didn't commit a murder. Well, murder is different than an accident, a homicide that occurs, and there's plenty of different ways it could happen, right? And I don't know that, but I don't think they committed a murder. But were they involved in an accident that occurred in the house?
You suspecting autoerotic asphyxiation?
I am not going in there,
right.
So just stop that.
Right. The worst. You never want to die from that.
Well, no comment.
But the case is captured the national attention.
Yes.
How much of you think that is because of the blogger sphere?
I think that plays a huge role in it. I think there's a couple things. One, it's an attractive white woman charged with murder of a police officer.
Okay.
Okay? Then it's police officers who are witnesses that happen on their front lawn, right? Then there's relationships between the investigating officers and the families. Then there is the bloggers who keep talking about it and dealing with it. So I think when you have all of that stuff, it makes it interesting for the media.
I find it really, really, again, the case is fascinating. 508-996-0. We're talking about the Karen Reed case. We have Representative Chris Markey here in the studio. Of course, he was a prosecutor in the Bristol County District Attorney's Office, and now he's a defense attorney here in the Commonwealth. One thing I found interesting was trying... These guys seem to at least be caught up in whether they knew Karen Reed or didn't know Karen Reed, and this is the Albert guy, and whether or not I think the federal agent may have had some romantic inclinations for her, and it's a very interesting, you know, why are they coming up with that stuff? What is the purpose of that, in your opinion?
Well, I think this is what you'd have to look at is you'd have to believe, and I think it's reasonable to infer that they're lying about that, is that they were trying to distance themselves from Karen Reed initially.
Okay.
Right? They didn't. So when they're under oath or when they're talking to the police a month later or whenever, they're like, oh, I don't know her. And, you know, John's just a guy we know kind of thing and all of that.
Right.
Right? So that it's not like they're not focused on them. Then all of a sudden when stuff starts happening and pictures of them together, they're in a wedding together, whatever, all those things that they've been able to show, they're still trying to deny that they're that close.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no reason for it, you know? But they'd have to explain away why they initially had those inconsistent statements. So I think they're trying to hide something. I don't know what they're trying to hide, but I think it's reasonable to assume they are hiding something.
Yeah.
And it could be that there was a homicide at their house, and it could be that they had some crazy night planned, and they were embarrassed by it, and they thought they could get rid of, you know, all of that, and who knows?
508-996-0500. The detective yesterday, it was interesting the way he was trying to deny. The guy who owns the house, the detective, retired now from the Boston Police Department, that he has any detective skills. It was really funny the way the guy goes, but you know this stuff. He was denying he had any training in different things, like how to cover up crimes or things like that. And eventually had to come around to admit that, yeah, of course I know what criminals try to do, and from my on-the-job training and my experience. Like everybody knows. I thought that was really interesting.
The lawyers have done a very good job of beginning to start to create reasonable doubt.
508-996-0. If we get some people on hold, we're going to take a quick break, folks. We have Chris Markey here in studio. Stick around. If you're on the hold line, stay there. We'll be right back. Some other things we can talk about, too, as well. But we've got some people on hold. Let's go to the phones. Good morning. Thanks for holding.
Hi, Chris.
Hi.
So one of the things that happened the other day that I thought was funny was, you know, the young kids that were hanging around the house were, you know, like Colin Albert's friends before the older people got back to the, you know, the house. A few of them had said that they saw, they saw her by herself, Karen Reed by herself. Two of the boys said they saw her by herself in her car with a dome light on and no John O'Keefe anywhere outside or in the car. So, they said, so at cross-examination, the defense says, now, these are prosecution witnesses saying they don't see him outside anywhere. And the defense says, did you see her hit anyone? And the press.
Oh, your phone dropped. That was on your end, I think. Maybe it was here. I don't know. If you want to call back, you can. 508-996-0500. Good morning. Thanks. You're on hold.
Hello.
Hi. Yes. Thanks for calling.
The one thing that I watch off and on, I just wondered about that broken glass in the snow. Does that mean that the victim had walked out with a glass, or do you think it'll play any part in it?
It's a great question. Thank you.
From what I've gathered is everyone had agreed that he had taken a glass from the last bar that they went to, but I don't know if I don't know how that will come out in the end. I don't know if there's other evidence that will show anything different. I thought there was some witness who said something about him taking it under his jacket or something like that. I don't know.
Or she had it under.
Yeah, someone.
Something like that.
Yeah.
What do you make of, I'm shocked, first of all, at how much information a witness has to give to the defense and prosecute. And I get it. It's, you know, it's, you got to put an adequate defense on. But your cell phone, right, with all the data on there.
Well, I think part of it is the way this thing has developed, you'd get the cell phone. Not in every case does that happen. No. I think the way this case has gone and the way the defense is, which just one thing is, you know, you talk about the witnesses. So this kid yesterday or the day before, Colin is his name, I think. He says he only spoke to the prosecutor for 10 minutes a month ago in preparation for this trial. Either he's lying, which I can't believe that a prosecutor would spend 10 minutes with him, or the prosecutor's totally incompetent and did it.
Really?
The reason why is because I don't, if you think about it, is the, you know, when I would interview somebody or when any DA interviews anybody is you first introduce yourself. Hey, my name's Chris Markey. I'm doing this. Where are you in school? What are you doing? What's your major? Do you have any activities? Why do you want all, like, just biographical background information that you would want so that you could try to, again, when you talk about at the end of the case, the credibility of the witness, that you can say, hey, here's this 20-year-old kid. This thing fell on his lap. He's a junior at Bridgewater State College, And you go through that whole, but you have to elicit that information. If you don't know it, just that in itself, that kind of introductory time is 5 to 10 minutes.
Right.
You know, and then you then say, hey, this is what you've said previously. So then you spend time on what you've said previously, and then you spend time on these are the questions I'm going to ask. I can't imagine a witness of that caliber, who's a young person you're going to need to spend more time with, that you wouldn't spend an hour and a half, an hour with at a minimum. And I find it hard to believe that it's a 10-minute conversation. I don't think the prosecutor did it for 10 minutes. I think he used probably an hour or so.
And the kid
and they
just
went over it. But wouldn't you expect that as a citizen? You'd want the prosecutor to have been prepared and knows all this stuff? Yeah.
Of course.
And I think Lally did that. But again, he's on the witness stand trying to minimize his influence by Lally because it's cross-examination.
508-996-0500. There is, and maybe this is just me, and maybe it was, but I sensed that during the cross-examination, they kept talking about this other grand jury. I think eventually they did call it the federal grand jury. But for a period of time, it seemed like they were trying to avoid, for some reason, mentioning that it was a federal grand jury. What's the reason behind that, if any?
There's a lot of times where judges instruct witnesses or instruct the parties that they can only describe another hearing, another case, or another circumstance of testifying as another hearing.
Okay.
I remember when I was in, I was a third in line on the last Cater case. And it's the fourth trial, and all the people testify, and the lawyers referred to, at another occasion you testified like this, at another hearing. Not saying it's another trial, but at another occasion you did this. And the reason why is you don't want that to prejudice the jurors and say, hey, what's going on in the other stuff? So that's all that is a protection of trying to protect both the process.
508-996-0500. We have Chris Markey here, and so we've got a bunch of other things I want to talk to him because, for instance, this case in Rochester where the young man's could get out of jail after murdering his whole family a few years ago, 30 years ago, something like that. I know you have some legislation on that, and there's a bunch of other stuff going on, but we have a bunch of people on hold. Good morning. Thanks for holding. You're on the air.
Good morning. How are we doing today?
Doing well. How are you?
Good. Chris, I got a question for you. Can the prosecution request that the charges be dismissed without prejudice at any point during the trial before it goes to the jury if the evidence continues to lean the other way?
They can do a couple of things. One is jeopardy is attached, so whatever if they have a motion now, it is dismissed with prejudice.
Which means what?
Because once a jury is sworn in, that means that jeopardy attaches, and under the Constitution, there's no double jeopardy. You can't be tried again.
Okay.
At the end of the government's case, I would assume, if it continues the path it's going, that the defense will file a motion for a directed verdict on the murder charge, and they would file a directed verdict on the operating under the influence of liquor, motor vehicle homicide, and they would do the same thing for the manslaughter operating under the influence. I don't think there's any evidence, at least to date, of her being under the influence at the time of operating her car. Everyone said, at least I haven't heard anyone say she appeared to be under the influence or anything like that.
I haven't heard that either.
I may have missed it, but that I think will be directed out. Even though they say she had alcohol in her system in the morning, that may be true, but maybe she drank after. But no one says she was drunk when she was operating her car. Of course, they may have been all drunk too, but right, the way they drink. But that's one thing I think the defense has been successful on. And the other thing is I don't know where they're going to get the murder from, because that is, I still don't see it, but maybe there's something more to it. I don't know. But I think those could get directed out, and the thing that would be left is motor vehicle homicide and leaving the scene.
What's the sentence for that?
There's a mandatory 1 year for both. So it would be 1 year or to serve. So you get 2.5, 1 year to serve on both. I don't think they can run concurrently, so it would be a total of 2 years.
508-996-0500. Good morning. Thanks for holding.
Chris, it's me again. I'm sorry, I dropped the call.
That's okay.
The defense asked those guys if they had seen her hit anyone with the car, and the prosecution raised an objection. I mean, that's their whole case. Why would you object to them asking that? That's your whole case, is that she hit somebody. But after that, I don't know, where they're getting it from, but the Howie Carr show says that Brian Higgins, the ATF officer, has a federal proffer. So if he's got a federal proffer, because he's pretty much the only one who's not related and was in that house, why would they let the trial go on if they think that there's another story there? You can answer off here. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. That's the call. Thank you.
First on the objection, it could have been the way the question was asked.
Okay.
So there's rules that requires questions to be asked in a proper way. That could have been the reason why you object. The other thing, just strategically, sometimes if you think that they're the other side's got a kind of a roll going, you just want to interrupt it just to slow them down and maybe get them off kilter a little bit. That sometimes you do that. As far as the federal proffer, I didn't know there's a federal proffer. I don't know all the details of everything,
right,
but I can say that it'll be interesting to see if he testifies and who he testifies for. Because the feds will have their own investigation. They'll keep it close-knit, and I just don't know if they'll have provided that information to the state police or the Norfolk DA's office.
There's a lot of stuff on Twitter, things out there, and again, I think that the citizen journalists, while they can be sometimes go too far, maybe. I think everybody needs an editor, but
I saw one the other day, like an offer of money for a witness to say that the kid was in a fight. That's not good for the defense either.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they would have to then go through everything and make sure they can believe it and it's accurate and all of that. But offering the money for a witness to do that is not a good move.
No,
not a good move.
But again, I think that the amount of information that people are putting out on Twitter and things like that, to me, again, I have to take everything with a grain of salt, you have to take everything in the New York Times with a grain of salt.
Even if those lines are in jest and kind of sarcastic, but it still doesn't, it would take away from anyone's credibility if they were to do that.
This murder that happened in Rochester about 30 years ago. We have a story at WBSM.com. The young man, he's not a young man anymore. He's grown up. He's been in prison for, I think, 30 years. He executed his whole family. So obviously they're not at the hearing, hoping he gets parole because they're not alive. Killed his sister, his parents in Rochester. You put some legislation forward on that.
Yeah.
Not that particular case, but...
No, but I want to say 10 years ago, the Supreme Court of the United States said that it was unconstitutional to have a juvenile sentenced to life without the possibility of parole. when I was on the judiciary, I was the vice chair, the chair left. So we did a, we had to accommodate that in within the statute and with a statute. And we did is we created a mechanism in which, depending on the theory that the person was convicted, would be the parole eligibility date.
Okay.
So I think it was like a felony murder, maybe like 10 years. Not 10 years, felony murder, 15, then deliberate premeditation is 20, and then the extreme atrocity is 25. So that was that. And then most recently, the Supreme Judicial Court of Massachusetts has changed it to 18 to 21-year-olds, I think, that they cannot be, they're emerging minds, they say, and they cannot be sentenced to life without parole.
18 to 21.
Yeah, so they can get sentenced. So I'm actually trying to figure out, I've called different DAs to see what the, take the temperature of if I filed something. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, in the current political climate, they're interested in doing anything different than what we already have. So they're going to be parole eligible at 20, 25, and 30 as well. I think they should be 25, 30, 35. But that's my opinion.
It is amazing.
Yeah.
Before we go back to the phones, Jesus Correa, back in the news.
Yeah, I read the article from the Fall River Herald News. I was taken. There's very few times I'm like surprised.
Yes.
This was shocking. I mean, Kevin Reddington is a premier lawyer in Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. He's a class act. He knows what he's doing. He's successful both business-wise and successful in the courtroom, very successful in the courtroom. The idea that he's going to hold hostage he's got a reputation,
yes.
Right? I mean, just think about it on a practical level. He doesn't want to lose. This is a high-profile case of a mayor, and he's saying that, oh, he wasn't going to give him his best defense. Totally, it's unconscionable. And I think, in the end, it's going to really, you're going to see a scathing opinion by a federal judge on that issue. And it is not going to help the former mayor at all.
Here is this guy, an inmate, who had every break in life, right? His parents worked really hard, put him through private school, Providence College, everyone else. And he's assassinating his lawyer's reputation. A man who's been at the top of his game for decades here in Massachusetts. And this guy is going to assassinate him from a courtroom? I mean, from a jail cell?
Yeah, it is preposterous. It's going to be interesting to see. And from least gathering from some of Kevin's quotes is that he's interested in not just letting this slide.
Right.
Because, again, it goes back to your reputation. Like, yes. He doesn't want to be known as that person. And I know he's not that person. So it will be interesting. And I'm sure Kevin will have plenty of documentation to show how much of a fraud it is. And it fits into the whole scam that he's had.
508-996-0500. We'll take this phone call. Good morning. Thanks for holding.
How you doing?
Hey, I'm doing well. How are you?
Not bad. Just a couple of things. Well, just to chime in on what you just said about Kevin Reddington. But you see big-time, high-priced lawyers that are really, really good get fired all the time and accused of what you're talking about. I don't see that. You know, when somebody's trying to get out of jail, they're going to do whatever they can, correct?
A lot of people will, yes.
That's the point, I think.
Right.
He'll say anything
right.
to try to get out of jail.
I think
but
that's more, right. Secondly, is that this is, it's a little bit close to home. You were talking about the young lady and what she may get or what's the penalty for, you know, say a vehicle homicide.
Yes. Yeah, Karen Reed.
It's been about 5 years now, but he just got out in January, I believe. My nephew, 17 years old. Really great kid, no problems in his life, just a really good kid. Him and his friend was driving, no drinking and driving, not like that. But he kind of stuck his nose out on the highway and hit a gentleman on a motorcycle, which veered off and ended up crashing and passing away. He ran home about a quarter of a mile away and got his father and came back to the accident. But the gentleman had deceased. But he was found guilty. and he got 1 year in prison, and you have to do every day of that 1 year, and he got out in January. Lost his license for life. I suspect that you probably could petition the registry of motor vehicles for like a Cinderella license or a work license after a certain amount of years, but that's a story. I mean, it's pretty sad.
No, it's sad. That's a very sad story.
No, that's what I was saying. It's a minimum mandatory of serving at least 1 year for both.
Folks, if you're thinking about, this is a beautiful, going to be a beautiful day out there. So if you're thinking about transforming your outdoor living space, maybe looking to do a patio, a walkway, a fire pit, or an outdoor kitchen, DeMello & Sons has you covered. Some of their great work, you can check it out on Facebook or their website, DeMelloLandscape.com. They are also into seal coating now, business and residential. They'll also do line painting. So if you have cracks or a bad look to your home or your business driveway, DeMello, the name associated with the best landscapes on the South Coast, can now help you with your driveway needs. Competitive pricing, always quality guaranteed. DeMelloLandscape.com or call 508-519-3019. Stick around. We're going to be right back.
There's a black box in the car.
Okay.
In her car, which would show how she was operating. I don't know if they have the capability of going back in time that far.
Okay.
So I don't know what will happen. But if that's in there and they can show around whatever it is, 12:30 or whatever time, that that she's backing up at a high rate of speed for a period of time. That would be interesting to see. And then how do they get that in? Is it going to be credible? Are they going to, the defense going to have an expert on that? Then the DNA. I assume that the defense really isn't going to challenge if his DNA is on the broken taillight.
Okay.
Because their theory is that it was planted there. So why would you fight that? They may talk about, you know, how was the evidence obtained? The lab technicians will still have to go through the process, but I think they will, the defense will then try to get out as much information as they can on the preservation of the evidence at the time and how it could be manipulated and all of that. So you might see that. I don't think that necessarily challenge that. They'd also talk about where the evidence should be, where DNA evidence should be, where blood evidence should be as a result of that.
Okay.
And then the medical examiner will be fascinating, I think, because those puncture wounds are the real thing. Like, how does that happen? It's a bizarre set of circumstances. And then finally, the phone, the search. I think the prosecutor is going to be able to explain away why it says 225 as opposed to opposed to when they believe it was happened at 625. That's just my gut, I think. And then there'll be the battle of those experts.
If you're on hold, stay there. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
84.
I was thinking about roller skating. Hot Wheels.
Yeah, well, I didn't do that.
You didn't?
No, I had a life.
Come on. Not in the eighth grade, you didn't have a life.
I would say that it's going to go into the second week, probably the second to third week of June, because there's a bunch of days off.
Is the jury sequestered here?
No.
They don't do that often, Massachusetts.
They might do it when they start deliberating. But
really?
Yeah, or if something happens.
The protests out there.
Yeah.
How difficult is that as a prosecutor and a defense attorney?
I don't know. I wouldn't pay much attention to it.
Okay.
I mean, it's kind of a silly thing, I think. I think there needs to be this kind of sacred area for jurors, and the integrity of the system really relies on that. So I'm not a big fan of it. I don't think it's helpful to one side or the other. I got a lot of other time on. I don't have a lot of other time on my hands,
right,
to be able to, you know, go out and protest and do those things.
I actually heard one of the commentators on court TV say, "We're not sure if these people are being paid." Something to that effect. In other words, how do you get all these protesters there? Is someone paying them? It was just speculation, but...
Well, they're just huge conspiracy theorists. But, you know, it's playing out to some degree.
Yep.
We'll see if it follows through.
Chris, I want to thank you for coming in. You're always available to us. I do appreciate that.
Yeah, no problem.
The Kevin Reddington thing is going to be very interesting.
That's worth going to see. Because Kevin is a tenacious lawyer. And I think, you know, one of the things that you hear is your word is your bond. Mm-hmm. And as a lawyer, that means a lot. And I think he takes that to heart. And I just don't know how the former mayor can say this stuff about him.
I hope there are consequences.
Yeah, there could be. I mean, there could be consequences of court costs and other things, right, for the fact that you bring a frivolous claim. He's got, what, 5 affidavits from 5 family members or something to that effect.
But Reddington wants to put them under oath, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That'll be interesting.
Oh, that would be a blast to watch.
Chris, we're out of time, but I really appreciate you coming in.
Yeah,
Thank you so much. Again, folks, Chris Markey.